Ever since the discovery of the ENS, or the enteric nervous system, in the 19th century, which is referred to as our second brain, we have discovered that there are about 500 million neurons in the gut that are connected to your brain through nerves in your nervous system. What we eat, especially foods that contain chemical additives and ultra-processed foods, affects our gut environment, causes obesity, and keeps us sick. And if there are 10 times more bacteria cells than human cells in the body, the importance of understanding the gut-brain axis and its role on obesity and weight loss becomes that much more important. In this video, I'll share with you three reasons why the bugs in your stomach matter when it comes to losing weight, as well as three ways in which we can support them to not only help you be healthy, but lose weight at the same time. If you guys are new here, my channel is all about helping you make informed decisions about your health and wellness, and I'd love for you all to gently tap on the like button down below. And if you really like the content, then consider subscribing as well. Also, if you guys are on Instagram, you can follow me there too. Now, without wasting any more time, let's dive right in. You see, the gut produces several hormones such as ghrelin and peptide YY, and these communicate with the brain to regulate appetite and satiety, right? Ghrelin, often called the hunger hormone, stimulates appetite, while peptide YY and other gut hormones promote feelings of fullness. And when you have imbalances in these hormones, what they do is disrupt the normal regulation of hunger and satiety, which leads to overeating and weight gain. In addition to these hormones, what we also know from the narrative review study on obesity and gut microbiota brain axis, it has also been demonstrated that the neural connection of the gut brain axis via the vagus nerve has a key role in changing eating behaviors and appetite. The second way in which the gut microbiome affects obesity is how the microbes themselves affect your food cravings and your food preferences. You see, we have certain gut bacteria that can actually produce metabolites that affect the reward centers in the brain, influencing your food choices and cravings for specific foods, including those that are high in sugar and fats. And yes, that includes donuts and chocolate. Here's a part that blows my mind. One bacteria in particular, Lactobacillus rhamnosus JB1, this guy here, he has been shown to influence the expression of GABA receptors in the regions of the brain related to emotions and behavior, i.e. the hippocampus and the amygdala nuclei. And guess what? Also modulates the anxiety behavior. This may also explain why we like to eat our feelings away and become emotional eaters. I like the 2014 study, Is Eating Behavior Manipulated by the Gastrointestinal Microbiota? It examined this and found that there is circumstantial evidence for a connection between cravings and the composition of gut microbiota. Individuals who are chocolate desiring have different microbial metabolites in their urine than chocolate indifferent individuals, despite eating identical diets, which again is really fascinating. The third way is how the gut microbiota play a role in the digestion and absorption of nutrients from food. Obviously, the foods we eat are going to be digested and absorbed, and there are certain types of bacteria in the digestion process that can break down complex carbs and fibers that otherwise are indigestible by human enzymes. In other words, we can't digest them, but our bacteria can. And when they do, they produce short-chain fatty acids as byproducts, two main ones which are butyric acid and propionic acid. And when that happens, it can affect energy metabolism and how fat gets stored in the adipose tissue. And there is data to support this. From the study from earlier, short-chain fatty acids, especially butyric acid and propionic acid, which we just mentioned, can enter the blood circulation and directly cause some alterations in the brain. And it really is crazy when you think about it, how these small creatures living inside us, being how small they are, but at the same time can create enormous differences to how we eat and digest foods. Short-chain fatty acids also affect the hormonal secretion of EECs, which are your enteroendocrine cells, by the activation of some specific G protein-coupled receptors, direct induction of the glucagon-like peptide 1, release of peptide YY, and indirect release of ghrelin, which are all responsible for eating behaviors. So now that we know how tremendous of an impact the gut microbiota have on our weight, what are some ways to support a healthy gut-brain axis so that we can lose weight and maybe even prevent obesity. The first thing you can do is eat your fermented foods. This includes yogurt, sauerkraut, kimchi, kombucha, including these foods in your diet as probiotics. To put it simple, I'll give you an analogy. In order for a safe neighborhood to exist in a city, you need good neighbors. You need a good community. Adding a healthy and diverse gut microbiota can help support improved metabolism, reduce inflammation, and help with weight management. And of course, getting rid of any highly processed foods, refined carbs, and added sugars. You need to get rid of these if you want to increase the odds in your favor. Secondly, and this goes back to creating a safe and prosperous neighborhood, make sure you're getting enough fiber. I remember when I had a comment once on my visceral fat video saying how I had no idea what I was talking about with how fiber can help with weight loss. Fiber acts as a prebiotic. It's nourishment for a beneficial gut bacteria to thrive in. When our gut bacteria is nourished, it supports all the previous systems and processes I just went over, which supports weight loss. And lastly, manage your stress. Notice how it didn't say eliminate stress. What we know is certain is that stress and depression can increase gut barrier permeability. Ever heard of the term leaky guts? Well, it can allow bacteria to seep into circulation, producing an inflammatory response. And indeed, both depression and stress can provoke heightened inflammation and gut leakiness. For example, a troubled marriage is a chronic stressor, right? We know one of the biggest stressors in life can be your relationships with friends and family. Most hostile couples had greater gut permeability than their less hostile counterparts, according to these studies. This is because troubled marriages are not an overnight fix. Your cortisol levels are sustained over longer periods of time, and that may impact the gut-brain axis. Interestingly, I don't know how accurate this is, but the most stressed out people live in Florida, and the least stressed seem to be in Iowa. I'm curious to hear what state you're from down below, and if you know of anything that helps with stress. Feel free to share with me down below. Curious to see if there was anything I missed or if you know of anything that helps as well. Leave them all down in the description below. And until then, guys, I'll see you on the next one.